Good morning. Just a very quick intimation that's not on your order of service. Normally on Easter Sunday we have a 9 a.m. communion, but because we don't have a minister in place at the moment, we're not having that. It'll just be the Easter Day service. However, if anybody would like Holy Communion on Easter Day, Lenzie Union do a Easter Praise and Communion service at 7 p.m. and you would be most welcome to join them in that service. However, there'll be nothing until 11 o'clock here on Easter Sunday this year. We'd like to welcome George Kelly again back to the pulpit again, and we look forward to sharing in worship with him. Thank you.
Good morning, and thank you, Eleanor, for your welcome. It's lovely to be here, and what a beautiful morning. I hope it's a morning when we can truly worship God. And you'll maybe have been given palm crosses as you came in. I didn't know whether there would be palm crosses available today or not, and I hadn't time to find that out. So there will be no mention of them during the service. But as Simon from Cyrene was recruited to help Jesus carry the cross, maybe we can use this as a symbol that we'll share in the carrying of that cross in whatever way we do, the burdens that we carry and the way we deal with people in the society that we live in. But for the moment, the choir will sing the introit. Our call to worship this morning is taken from Psalm 118. It's verses 1 and 2, 22 and 23 and 29. And there is a response which is on the screens, and it's the bit in bold which is for you to say. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let Israel say, his love endures forever. The stone which the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. So let's come before the Lord today, lifting our hearts in praise, and maybe be ready to follow him with Hosanna on our lips and love for him in our hearts. God of love, help us to recognize Jesus as the one who comes in your name, as the one who blesses and saves us. As we explore your word this morning, may we offer true praise and adoration in our worship. May we be open to learn more about your ways, and may we resolve to walk the road with Jesus every day. So let's stand as we're able to sing our first hymn. O worship the King. And if you're using a hymn book, it's number 127. Let's join our hearts and minds in prayer. Almighty and eternal God, thank you that we have the freedom to meet together today, to remember the triumphal journey that Jesus made into Jerusalem. Thank you that we will be joining with churches all around the world who will be gathering to do the same. We long for our cities, towns, and villages to be united in the way that Jerusalem was on that first occasion when the whole city took part in the celebrations. We may not be cutting palms and spreading cloaks as they did, but we ask that our eyes, ears, and hearts would be open to see and hear what you are calling us to do in your name. We acknowledge you as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You are enthroned on high. Draw us close as we worship you. Teach us to love as you do. Forgive us for the times we don't honor you in the way that we behave or act towards others. For the times We don't respect our Christian festivals the way we should. When we follow the crowd because it's the easy thing to do, even when you are being disrespected. Help us to have the courage to do what you ask, even when it may be costly. We ask your forgiveness for the times when we choose to go our own way and only turn to you as a last resort instead of a first response. Gracious God, you always know what's in our hearts, even when we feel lost in our wrongdoing. Thank you that you are always there to pick us up and put us back on the right track and to bring new life and forgiveness into our lives. May your will be done as we seek to emulate and honour the example of Jesus Christ, your Son, who taught us to pray in these words: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, as I look around the church, without wanting to be contentious in any way, I'm sure a fair proportion of the people here would remember an entertainer from many years ago, Max Bygraves. Was that even stretching it for the people here? He used to have a catchphrase, which was, "I'd like to tell you a story." Well, I'd like to take a leaf from his book and tell you a story this morning. It's one that involves our family, people's expectations, and God's response to prayer. People are sometimes puzzled by God's apparent lack of response when they pray. I think this little family story is a good illustration of what's happening some of the time. When my son was growing up, he had a favorite author. And my wife and I were in town one day, and we noticed that that author was doing a book signing in Waterstones. Ideal, we thought. We'll buy his new book, have it signed, and keep it for Christmas. So far, so good. But not long after that, our son, Ali, became aware of the new book being available, and he asked if we could go into town and buy it. And normally that's exactly what we would have done. However, on this occasion, we made all kinds of excuses and apparently had turned a deaf ear to him. He couldn't understand why. He didn't appreciate that the answer wasn't no, it was not yet. Because we knew we had something much better planned for later. And I think sometimes when we pray about things, God sees a far greater priority in our lives that he deals with first before addressing the more maybe mundane things that are of such great importance to us. On a much grander scale, today's gospel reading is dealing with that area of our relationship with God. The people had realized that they needed God's help, and they imagined that they understood how he would give it. As we'll see later, God's understanding of what kind of help was needed was very different. Part two will follow later. So for the moment, we're going to sing again. And the words are based on what Paul has to say in the passage that we're about to read from the letter he wrote to the Philippians. Again, we'll stand as we're able to sing number 458, at the name of Jesus. We hear now from the Word of God.
Our first scripture reading is from Philippians chapter 2, reading from verse 5 to 11. So that's chapter 2, 5 to 11, found on page 1179. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in an appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
The anthem, while Mary was watching, they hung Jesus high.
Thank you.
Our second reading is from Mark chapter 11, reading from verse 1 to 11. Page 1015. The Triumphal Entry. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you doing this?' tell him, 'The Lord needs it and will send it back here shortly.'" They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, "What are you doing untying that colt?" They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road. While others spread branches they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming of the kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest." Jesus entered Jerusalem and went to the temple. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. Amen, and thanks be to God for these readings of his holy word, and to him be all honour, glory, and praise.
Thank you, Liz. We're going to sing again, number 356, Meekness and Majesty.
Thank you.
So here we are at part two. And this time, I'm not going to be speaking about books. I'll be speaking about cloaks. That's maybe a confusing thing to say if you live in the Glasgow area. So just to clarify, I should say I'll be talking about the ones that will be put forward, or not talking about the ones that will be put forward next week. I'll be talking about the kind that Sir Walter Raleigh famously threw over a muddy puddle so that Queen Elizabeth I didn't get her feet dirty. Whether he knew it or not, what Sir Walter did was very much in the tradition of how people in ancient times showed their allegiance to the king or some other ruler. In 2 Kings, when Jehu was appointed or anointed king over Israel, his friends spread their cloaks on the steps under him. And of course, as we read today, when Jesus entered Jerusalem, he was greeted like a king. People threw their cloaks on the ground. Some were placed on the donkey, and palm branches were waved, and the whole atmosphere was one of rejoicing and celebration, just as it would have been if a king or a great general had returned in triumph after a conquest. It was the custom in those circumstances for the hero to ride on a donkey. The donkey indicated peace. Horses were for war. It has been suggested that the word used for the cloak that people would have thrown on the ground is sometimes translated as garment, and was in fact the tallit, or the prayer shawl, which was a seamless garment which had a tassel attached to each of the four corners to remind the Jewish people of all the commands of God. The letters on the collar spell Lord of Lords and King of Kings as a symbolic reminder of the promised Messiah. Laying their tallits down would have been the perfect way for the people to suggest that Jesus was that promised one of God. They were declaring that he was the one worthy to be called the Lord of Lords and King of Kings. In Jerusalem and its surrounding villages, the great stories and the oral tradition of those times were still being told. Some of them had maybe even been written down by this stage, but one of them would have been about the famous Judas Maccabeus, who around 200 years earlier had arrived in Jerusalem after conquering the pagan armies that had oppressed Israel. And he had been given a similar welcome into the city by a crowd waving palm branches, and he'd also been hailed as the Messiah. No wonder the crowds were filled with excitement now. On the surface, everything was going wonderfully well. To all appearances, they had found the Messiah they were waiting for. Jesus seemed to be doing all that they were expecting. But in reality, things were very different. Where the crowd saw a triumphant conquering hero who would free them from the tyranny and oppression of occupation, Jesus was intent on becoming the triumphant, suffering servant who would free them from the tyranny and oppression of sin and death. Where the crowd celebrated the arrival of the one who would fulfill prophecy by saving them from Rome, Jesus was fulfilling prophecy by saving them from themselves. I wonder what difference it would have made to the people at that time if they'd had the benefit of Paul's words to the Philippians. In your relationship with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage, Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. Excuse me. Even today, when people turn to God, very often it's only when we reach crisis point in some aspect of our lives. Usually when we've exhausted every other solution we can think of. Prayer is a last resort, not the first response. Of course, as I mentioned earlier, Jesus will answer every prayer, but maybe not in the way that might be expected or at the time we would like. His priorities are vastly different from ours. What seemed to the people in Jerusalem at that time like the culmination of centuries of anticipation, the triumphal arrival of the Messiah, was certainly a moment to celebrate. But although they couldn't know it at the time, it was only the beginning of the final act in the drama that was about to be played out over the next week. Jesus was about to confront not just the might of Rome and the misguided, corrupt power of the Sanhedrin, but the forces of evil which had caused humanity to become estranged from God and had brought death and corruption into the world in the first place. The only way for Jesus to eradicate the finality of death and the stranglehold of sin and evil was for him to confront them, to experience them, and overcome them. Everything in and around Jesus' life had been directed towards this key moment. The multi-layered prophecies concerning his lineage, the circumstances leading up to and surrounding his birth, the angelic interventions, the interlinked lives, the significance of his cousin John the Baptist, Mary, his mother, the place where he was to be born, even the kind of death he would die, and the details around that. Events from centuries before that were full of symbolism, which were now taking on new significance and were racing towards the glorious culmination of the greatest rescue mission ever imagined. A rescue mission that included you and me before we even existed. If Jesus had simply arrived quietly in Jerusalem and moved discreetly through the streets, the authorities would probably not have taken such an interest in him. But his actions, to those who knew and understood the scriptures, would have been seen as a direct challenge to the ruling parties. Although Mark doesn't mention it, Matthew's version of this gospel story quotes the prophecy from Zechariah, which speaks of a king who will save his people. To the Jewish people, that could only mean one thing: the revolution was about to begin. No one would have had any understanding of the kind of change that Jesus was going to bring about, or what kind of kingdom he was going to establish. Even more impossible for the people of those times to grasp would be the concept of a kingdom that itself would be so contradictory, so opposite in its values and behavior. A kingdom that could simultaneously exist now and still be yet to come. A kingdom that would involve not just the Jewish people, but the Gentiles as well. A kingdom that would embrace not just all of them, but the generations still to come. A kingdom that would be left in the care of its subjects and not be fully established until the king returned. A conquering, triumphant king who brought life instead of death and destruction. A king who established his kingdom at enormous cost in order to give freedom to us. That gift was freely given, but it requires his followers to engage in the risky business of inviting the rest of the world into his kingdom by displaying extraordinary levels of love, especially to those who oppose them, just as he did. Palm Sunday is a day of joyful celebration, but it's also a day for sober reflection and humility. And despite all that's to happen in the next week or so, it gives us the first glimpse of the King of Kings riding in majesty, the Messiah, the Savior of the world who would conquer the ultimate enemy, death. And despite what people may have imagined, a first glimpse of the long-expected one who challenges us to follow him, to emulate him in overcoming the world with love. He was quite unexpectedly what might be seen as the ultimate contradiction, the servant king, the king of peace. Amen. So let's celebrate the contradiction that exists in Jesus' triumphal entry in the city, where his final battle was about to begin. This is number 365. Ride on, ride on, in majesty.
Let's make our offerings to God. Almighty God, giver and sustainer of life, thank you for all that we have and all that we are. From everything that you've provided, we bring these gifts today, along with our talents and abilities, and what has been given by other means at other times. And we present them to be used for your purposes and to your glory. Amen. We continue in prayer now for others. Lord Jesus, we come to you today to celebrate that you are the King. Thank you for all the aspects of your glory that we see in the world around us. Spring flowers, new buds and bushes and trees, lighter evenings, all the wonderful signs of life and renewal at this time that remind us of new life in you. Saviour of the world, we know that you are the King, reigning in heaven as you promised you would. But it must sadden you when you look at the world today. We bring before you the places that are hurting, oppressed and afraid, especially areas near where you yourself once walked. We pray especially for the people of Israel and Gaza, Ukraine and Russia, as they pursue the conflict between them, and Russia independently because of the awful atrocity that's happened in their theatre. We think of the people of Yemen and Syria, Haiti, Myanmar, and all the other countries where violence, oppression, and injustice blight their lives. Lord, we know that you've promised to make all things new. We pray that you will bring healing to the nations. Lord, we celebrate the fact that you've placed us in communities, in nations, cities, towns and villages, in workplaces, schools and family units. We bring our whole nation before you, and we pray for King Charles and Princess Catherine as they continue with treatment for cancer. We pray for our leaders in government, both locally and nationally, with all the decisions they need to make. May they know the wisdom and guidance of your Holy Spirit. We pray for those who have had to leave their countries because of war, famine, or persecution. As these displaced people seek safety in other lands, we ask for your intervention, that they will be treated with love and respect, and that they would avoid exploitation. Help us to be peacemakers as you were, to be people of love, putting others first in humility as you did. Lord Jesus, we thank you for this church community. We pray for our leaders, for those who contribute to the life of the church in any way. We pause for a moment to lift to you those sitting near us today, whether we know their names or not. Guide us as we welcome those around us who are different from us, but loved by you just the same. Help us to be people of humility, wanting what is best for others and not for ourselves. May your church be known in the community as a place where love, acceptance and joy are found. For the Church of Scotland, we seek your guidance and blessing as we look for solutions to the challenges which face us as an organisation. We pray for the inspiration of the Holy Spirit to flood through everyone involved in decision-making at a personal, parish, presbytery or national level. May your will be done as we search for a way to unite your church and honour the example you set us. In the silence, We pray for any in this community who have been bereaved, are sick, are hurting, or are in need of help right now. Help us to support them with our love. Lord Jesus, as we go forward into this most important of weeks, as we follow you through Holy Week, your betrayal, crucifixion, and death, help us to do what you did for us. We will never truly know the depths of love you went to for us, but we thank you with all our hearts as we look forward to celebrating the most wonderful, important, world-changing event in history, your resurrection. Help us to see signs of resurrection and regeneration everywhere we go this week and in whatever we do. As we celebrate your majesty today and as we seek to emulate and honor your example, may your will be done in our lives. Amen. We're going to stand again as we're able to sing our final hymn, which is a celebration of Jesus as God's chosen Messiah. This is number 474, Hail to the Lord's Anointed.
And as we leave this place, may we be filled with the love of Christ and a new enthusiasm to take the gospel everywhere we go. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit fall on us and remain with us forever.
Thank you.